श्रीमती रामानुजाय नमः। शास्त्रस आर डिवाइन, थ्री अनऑडिबल स्टेजेस ऑफ मैटर एज वेल एज द स्पीशीज इन साइड द वर्ल्ड। वन इज नोन एज वृद्धि, सेकेंड इज नोन एज क्षय एंड थर्ड इज नोन एज स्थगन। इट इज अपग्रेडेशन, डिग्रेडेशन एंड स्टैग्नेशन। दीज थ्री थिंग्स आर द अनऑडिबल स्टेजेस ऑफ द सस्टेनेंस ऑफ द वर्ल्ड। And we know that we are very much interested in pragati or growth or development in all of our aspects. And whenever the growth is in something in which we are desirous, which is salubrious to us, which is in the progressive mode for the development of all living beings in all spheres of life, we used to call it as a tremendous growth. At the same time, if the same thing is pernicious, unwanted, fatal in nature, the growth is defined as cancerous growth. So the growth of some unwanted thing, which is going to put an end drastically or gradually, that type of growth we used to call it as cancerous in nature. And this cancerous is a common word. The cultural infusion and westernization or so called unhealthy modernization is a cancer to our tradition. The so-called innovative growths of science and technology without understanding the roots of a land, that is a challenge and cancer to one's heritage. And terrorism is a cancerous growth on patriotism. And each and everybody is a disciplinarism, and a person's precision and perfection is cancerously affected by aberration like addiction, alcoholism, etc. So each and everything, apart from the cancer that affects our body, anything that has its own cancerous growth affecting the basic moorings of our land, of the global society even, they have to be taken in similarity or in proximity with the same cancer, and a totalitarian approach for eradicating all must be immediately made into practical implementation. So the growth of a society that depends in some major units. One is a person's physical fitness. Second is a person's mental stability. Third thing is a person's productive intellect. Fourth thing is a person's spiritual integrity. So if all of these things are not balanced, that society cannot get into consummate success or perennial success or a source of success that can permeate and radiate the surroundings. It may be either infinitesimal, transient, or it may be semi-successful even. So when we take into the various moorings I've already mentioned, in order to create integrity through Indian community or integrity within community, which is defined as Aikya Bharati, Aikya Bharati has two definitions. It is Bharatiyanam Aikya Bhavaha, Bharata Deshat Prapanchasya Aikya Bhavasya Jnana Vitaranancha. So if you want to establish Aikya Bharati, that is integrity of our Bharatiya community, or integrity, the message of integrity from our community to the world with leadership, no doubt there are four pillars, that is spiritual precision, intellectual commitment, mental stability and physical salubrity. And one of the pillar is our physical salubrity, and one among the greatest challenges to that is cancer. So apart from cancer, not only conducting cancer, but also conducting similar lectures in Aikya Bharati about the mental cancerous permeation, the intellectual cancerous permeation, and the nescience, atheism, skepticism, communalism and demoralization of the society, which is nothing but a spiritual cancer. All of these diseases are to be discussed, treated, planned and executed from Aikya Bharati. So it is the first session which deals with the physical salubrity. So thus, it is the greatest contribution of sagacity, viveka, which can find similarities between differences and differences between similarities. Identities in disparities and disparities are cleavages amidst identity. That is a prudential work of sagacity, on the basis of which we can now claim that it is a really useful subject, connected and relevant subject that has institutional relevance, constitutional relevance of our nation. Number third, contemporary relevance of the present trend of society. So it is a first series of lecture, and let us start it very successfully, very brilliantly, very deeply. And you know that janma mrityu jara vyadhi, according to Shastras, there are four levels of human nature or spiritual nature. The first thing is the process of birth, and the last thing is death, amidst which two unavoidable things are there. One is aging, and the second thing is malady or disease. This morbidity, even though that is unavoidable, there are a lot of process of maintaining a clean atmosphere, maintaining a clean inner sphere, maintaining a clean body, and maintaining a proper mental and ethical health that can make you to control within yourself and also to permeate into control of the disease over the society. So the Vedas, they have advocated, apart from medicines, medications and meditations. Meditations are meant for the supply of your inner will and its potential output in controlling, diagnosing and preventing the diseases. Whenever they are insufficient, whenever they are not immediately implementable, there the secondary implementation is of the medication. So our people, they were less concentrating on medication, they concentrated more on meditation. So which requires a balanced mind, intellect and body. So let us start with cancer. Cancer is not at all a disease. There is no disease in the world known as cancer. Cancer is the uncontrollability of a normal disease. When a normal disease reaches an area where it is beyond the control of both the immunity of the body and neurosignal processing, that reaches the stage of cancer. Just as a person becomes a mukta, he becomes free from the bondage of the world, that type of that malicious and malodial germ or atom or cell structure inside the body that reaches such a state that it is far beyond the control of the bodily immunity and the inbuilt resistance systems through the neurological and biological values. So let us define cancer. What is cancer? Cancer, the medical term of cancer is malignant neoplasm. There are two neoplasms, benign and malignant. So neoplasm, that denotes that a plasmic substance, a new variety or abnormality of the genetic material or the bodily material inside, if it becomes malignant, that is known as cancer. What is the quality defined by the status of being malignant? There are three things. One is uncontrollable growth and division. Second thing is invasion. Third thing in medical term, it is known as metastasis. So one is vriddhi. It is known as kuvriddhi, not suvriddhi. It is known as kuvriddhi. And second thing is known as invasion. It is known as pravesha. Third thing is metastasis, which is known as vyapti. So if something is there which is having uncontrollable growth, that also becomes deep inside your body as well as permeates and affects the other connected organs and proximate organs, that malignant nature is defined as cancer. Cancer has more things to do with us. Number one, in India only real medicines for cancer, they are available both from the medical field and paramedical field, submedical field and other alternative systems. We do have lot of things. And we only have designed and divined the greatest dominant factors for the creation and uncontrolled introduction about cancer. Cancer seeds in various places. Just as a person attacks a weaker person or a gullible person, he cannot cheat an intellectual person or he cannot fight with a robustic person. Immediately he seeks for a person where the weakness or where the gullibility of the person can be taken shelter. Likewise, cancer, it takes some parts inside our body which are soft in nature, which has some sort of possibility for expansion of the blood cell vessels so that it can be well seated, well nourished and developed. So it sees some particular places. There are main places where frequently the rate of being cancerous is more. There is one sukta known as Akshibhyamte Nasikabhyam in Rigveda as well as in Atharvaveda. There must be an institute for the health, the holistic health, in which Vedic healing must be at least experimented. You take two or three persons, we are not going to get any money for that. This Akshibhyamte Nasikabhyam is very much essential. In each and every Ange Ange Lome Lome Yastu Parvani Parvani, in each and every cell joint and each and every hair root and each and every tissue of your body, I uproot the malodial measure that has taken seat in your body. This is the meaning of that mantra. To take that recitation, it will take a lot of time. Explanations will be limited then. So next time, just I want to chant only one class for mantras, and properly they must follow those mantras and they can practice daily as well as do it for the welfare of the others. So these melodial elements, they are secreted in various places. The major area is lung for males and breast for the females. So it is, first it starts with bladder, then it roots in also our pancreas, it is also there in our lungs, breast, ovary, then leukemia, which is there in the permeated blood flow. So these are the various areas of cancer. Apart from which, why I am saying this, these areas are very much prone to cancer. Just as we are very much concerned with accident prone areas, whenever we are moving in highways, wherever there is a hairpin bend, wherever there is low visibility, low ground level, etc., we take more caution. Likewise, every day, by doing mantras of Sudarshana, Dushtam dharaya dharaya, Duritam hana hana, Papam dakadha, Rogam martaya martaya, all of these mantras are there. Daily you can practice any mantra of your choice. At least you can touch the sensitive portions which are very much prone to the cancer. Today, just even though I cannot eradicate cancer in the society, in which God is also engaged in the same process through lot of executives, and still he is moving on. So at least I can just wish and bless that the persons available here must not have any prospective infusion of cancer and also their associates and dependents. That is my will. So for that, at least for these portions which are very much sensitive and prone to that cancer, we must touch and we must chant those mantras. And you know that each and every disease, it has its own symptoms. There are two types of studies. One is multi-melodial study and multi-symptomic study. A single disease, it may have different types of symptoms for the same disease. Different diseases, they may have the same symptom. Most of the cancer symptoms are very normal symptoms. One is swelling, second is pain, third is bleeding, fourth is ulceration, fifth is loss of weight, sixth is loss of appetite and fatigue, then anemia, all of these things, sweat, especially nocturnal sweating, night sweating. All of these things are effective symptoms of cancer. So whenever these symptoms occur, it will create, there are a lot of people who due to lack of proper care, they have made cancer to grow. That is the flaw of negligence. And if you say these symptoms to people, there will rise one more fallacy or flaw of creating more phobia. Because these symptoms are very normal with 80% of the people. And after coming to know about these symptoms, their nocturnal sweating and fatigue will grow more. It will be intensified. And whenever they are getting into such things, symptoms, as it has been already told, they will be afraid of a prospective cancer or an available cancer. So proper way of guidelines is, these are all some symptoms of that type of cancer which has just now entered the inceptive or the incubation level. It does not mean that they are in danger. So whenever a person is having a particular symptom like this, there are two possibilities. It may be an innocuous symptom of your general body weakness, number one. It may be of a benign tumor which may not be permeating your body, resulting in fatal death, but it may cause some pain or some problem here. Third thing, it may be also a malignant tumor. The possibility is just 5%. But 5% among 100 crores, you can just imagine. Because 2007, the World Cancer Report, it has said 7.6 million people died in cancer, 2007. So the percentage may be less, but certainly a lot of people are affected by different types of cancers, like political cancer of malpractice and misadministration, then terrorism, international clashes, then border disputes, various things we discussed here also, amidst which this type of cancer also rules the society. What is the reason for this cancer? There are three major reasons. We have to understand these reasons, then only we can understand the Vedic practices. Number one, it is due to the carcinogens. These carcinogens are created from substances like alcohol and tobacco, etc. They exist more in such substances. This is the first reason. And second is error in DNA replication. And third thing is heredity. You must have inherited from your ancestors, just you have taken their properties. It is an inherited property in the form of a disease. So these three things are the major things. Then there is a special study which is known as, it is the pathobiology. It is known as the pathobiology of cancer, or the clinical pathology of cancer, or it may be called as a cancer pathobiology or a cancer pathology. So it states that there are some other reasons. Four major reasons have been given. We must very much clearly understand these things. Tobacco and other things, whatever we are depicting in the advertisements or in the health declarations, those things are having only a limited domain. Major things are controlled by unseen factors. Number one, it starts with the demethylation of our DNA. And due to microRNA, then there are two genes inside our body. One is known as oncogene, second is known as tumor suppressing genes. Our oncogenes, they must be deactivated. Simultaneously, they exist like Devasuras. These oncogenes, they must be deactivated. And this suppressing gene of the tumor, they must be activated. Due to some biological error or some inheritance or any other mutation or specific variation in the DNA pre-programmed structure due to unavoidable and unknown regions, we can clearly consider that there will be a cancerous growth. So it started with the activation of oncogenes and deactivation of the second genes, which are just mentioned, just created for suppressing the tumors. If they are deactivated, then this thing will be boosted. So it creates 8 major variations inside your body. It is very important to know about these variations. Number one, each and every body, certainly it has a limited growth. If there is hyperactive growth and division, that is a symptom, that is a product of this malignant arrangement. Number one is hyperactive growth. Second thing, sir, is a processive cell death. Immediately it must die and must be regenerated. That the processive cell death is also affected by this type of collaborations. And the third thing is, we are having our own way of understanding tissue borders. Just as we respect borders and we pay taxes and get inside and we maintain our limitations and demarcations, there are cell boundaries and tissue boundaries. Whenever a cell becomes cancer and becomes invasive and pervasive, it won't mind the borders. It can cross boundaries and reach any area for affecting. So that sense of understanding and limiting oneself within the boundaries is lost. That is the third thing. The fourth thing is, there is a process of not responding to varying or contrary atmospheres. If the environment is in diversified portion or status, the natural healthy cells, they won't respond. They will be against that. The immunity inside the cells, immediately if something is against our body health, immediately they will act against it. But this cancerous cell or the so-called malignancy, that will prevent the reaction against this abnormal environments. The fifth thing is cell cycle. There is a cell cycle of growth. Mitosis, meiosis, you must have read. The cell cycle of productivity is disturbed by these things. And moreover, there is a process of DNA replication. That DNA replication is totally arrested in these cancerous cells. Moreover, there are two relations within the body tissues. One is being adhesive to its own tissues and also interaction with protective cells. These cancerous cells become totally a different type of alien, that it does not respond or being adhesive to its own group of tissues. For example, if it is a throat cancer, it will not communicate with any cell of your throat, any tissue of your throat function. It will not also collaborate or cooperate with the other protective tissues of your body. So these 8 things are the major variations which are created inside the body. And if you have the major variations which are created inside the body, and if you have to remove all of these things, daily you have to enlighten your body immunity. There must be a daily practice. Today morning I have already told, there is a routinal practice. Second thing is a processive practice. Third thing is an upgradatory practice. If anybody properly doing this thing, they can get a very effective emergency practice. If somebody is not doing routinely or upgradingly or processively, immediately approaching a power or a process for the rescue, it won't help at all. Today I told, Apatkale Vahanabhyasavat. At the time of your emergency or your problem, you cannot practice immediately bike driving or car driving or boating, and you cannot escape. It is a normal practice to be practiced at a casual mode, which will come for rescue. Today I have explained the same thing in the morning. Same thing I want to say. Every day, at least 10 minutes, whatever I told you in English, you think that and plan a process in your own language and style to God, that these type of unwanted elements within my side, which affects the cell cycle, cell relations, tissue adhesion, and also interaction with the mother protective tissues of my body, which is not cooperating with the DNA replication, that type of element, if you have more information, you can just think that my cancer must go away. That is entirely different. But if you know more about the cancer, if there is a wicked fellow, you might have seen in films that there will be a lot of wicked fellows having made murder or something else. If the secret is known to somebody, immediately the person will be frightened on the vision of the person. Likewise, if you know more about the disease, and also the disease causing enzymes, and more you know about the curing factor, that is your own inner light or spark of God, the more you know about two these things, the disease will be afraid of you instead of your fear towards the disease. So knowledge that reduces fear and that accelerates the gear, and it makes you to reach at the utmost destination without any infallibility, without any fallibility. That is the greatness. So these are some of the explanations. These eight major variabilities created inside a body has nothing to do with the so-called alcohol or tobacco or anything that. These things are additives, which we are going to say. These things are going to be additives for the already existing gene mutation or any program with your DNA, etc. Now we are having 10 therapies. We are having hundreds of therapies in our land. Touch therapy, thought processing therapy, transmission therapy, then cognitive therapy, conceptive therapy, then immanence therapy, immunity therapy, mutual transfer therapy, lot of therapies are there in Acharya Shisha and Purohita procedures. In Vedas, there are lot of Purohitas, lot of sacerdotal authorities, and they have claimed that, yes, I remove your disease. Nidravantu bahir bilam. Yes, I command your melodial concrete. Let the crude, deep-rooted, concentrated melodial team, that it come out of your body through urination, or perspiration, or excretion, or vaporization, whatever it may be. So that is the command of Vedas. And next time, no doubt, we have to print through Sharada Jnanapitha some essential shlokas, which they can do experimentally, but that is a dangerous experiment. They can at least go for the guidance with proper Vedic people who knows the attunation and accentuation of the Vedic modules with which we exactly come at the real efficacy, instead of being getting into the danger, thinking something and rendering something for a different cause. So you may think something, but if the attunation and that accentuation is different, whatever you may be thinking, it will represent a different idea, contrary to your desire and will. So proper guidelines must be mentioned here. 10 therapies are there, 10 process of treatment now we are doing. The major thing is surgery. Johnson, a very great surgeon and also a creative thinker, he told, a real and capable surgeon is not a person who successfully does it, but tries to avoid it with his best skill. So if you know surgery and if you have a surgical knife, you must not be just cutting like vegetables or a butcher's shop. So we must not be doing that. The maximum way of, because whatever we remove from your body, we don't have the type of the Madhukari Vidya. Without causing even a small fraction of pain or uncomfortable status to the pollens of a flower, the honeybee is capable of extracting, sucking the honey. Without causing even the most infinitesimal uneasiness to that of the pollens, not even the flower, pollens of that much of treatment of a very much precisely targeted medication is not available in our science now. There is a targeted medical therapy is there, but they are not successful. Because each and every cell is interconnected. They are having internal connection, intra-connection and interconnectivity. So this type of things, by the modern medication, the surgery is the immediate work. Immediately they will say that your life is in threat. Immediately you have to operate it within 24 hours. So this type of threat makes them, prevents them from going for thinking of any alternative remedy. That much of perplexity is created. I don't say that it must be totally avoided, but I believe, or most probably it must be so, that 65% of the operations are preventable and unnecessary. That's my statement. So a lot of other areas where amputation is done at emergency, those things we cannot just claim. If somebody is advised not to do that, then we must do that. So we cannot just totally be blaming or accusing the process of surgery, but there are a lot of preventable surgeries. One is surgery, second is the radiation therapy. The ionic radiation which penetrates inside the body, that high power radiation, it may be either internal or even external radiation is there. That radiation immediately burns the cancer cells and creates a possibility of hyper acceleration of the same cells to be reproduced again. That is a little different. That is radiation therapy. And the third thing is, we have chemotherapy with cytotoxins. What are cytotoxins? These cytotoxins are highly powerful chemical compounds which, if injected inside, they totally burn these cancer cells. So this chemotherapy is very worse. Any person advocating the chemotherapy, they are doing for the reason that they can be relieved from the pain. It is an interim relief from the pain. It immediately results in hyperemetic sense, more vomiting, loss of hair, loss of appetite, the person being totally molten into just a skeleton. So it gives a very cruel way of life. So the post-chemotherapeutic life is more cruel and clumsy. But still, so many people are going after it because of the excruciating pain with which they cannot live. So this is the third thing, chemotherapy. Fourth thing is immunotherapy. It is by process of institutionalizing or installing a hyperimmune structure inside your body. That is known as immune therapy. Then hormone therapy. Hormone therapy, by instituting hormones inside your body, which can redeem the hormonal imbalance and give you that benefit. Then there is the angiogenesis, which is very famous, that is now recently coming. Then targeted therapy, now in nanotechnology also, if you are sending some other medicine inside, that will totally ulcerate the passage. A nanoparticle of gold has been now tested in the Berkeley Research Institute, and it went inside, and that is very much useful for detecting the exact area, drug delivery. It is known as digital drug delivery, and immediately there the person is medicated. So that type of tip of that nanoparticle will consist of anti-cancer drugs. If anti-cancer drugs are orally given or injected or intravenously installed, that may harm everything and that may be diluted. So a cancer, anti-cancer drug, a cancer resistant, that is installed in a nanoparticle, and by digital drug delivery that is sent inside. These things are now modernly very much available. Then now there is a symptomic study. It is known as symptomic study or symptomic control. If you understand the symptom, there is a process of control by which so many lifestyle and habits are changed, by which cancer is treated. This is known as symptomic control. And we are having supplementary medicine and alternative medicine. Supplementary medicine is any medicine. If a single medicine is incapable in cancer relief, a group of medications are available in the allopathy. That is known as supplementary medicine. Now let us come to alternative medicine. We have wonderful medicines in our Ayurveda. And I want to say something. There are two major sciences. One is known as pharmacokinetics. Second is known as pharmacodynamics. The response of your drug to the medicine and response of the medicine to the drug respectively. This is what we call pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics. We cannot just say that I can cure cancer. Where is the cancer seated? What is the history or stage of the cancer? What is the food habit or the general salubrity level of the patient? And what is the drug response of the patient to that body? And if there is any imbalance of these things, how much you can upgrade and compensate? Your capability of upgradation and compensation. If you see that now, the Ayurveda is more than enough for treating 50% of the cancer patients. Among all the cancer patients, 50% can be cured. Number two, even in case of advanced stages, 25% of the people, they can be cured. They are taking into very highly effective and volatile substances. There are a lot of things. One is known as Hiraka Bhasma. Second is known as Vajrabhraga Rasayana. In the Rasayana Shastra, Hiraka, you know, diamond. Diamond by means of an alchemic process, that is. So the calcinated carbonate compound form of diamond is known as Hiraka Bhasma. And the second thing is Vajrabhraga Rasayana. Vajra is no doubt diamond, and Abhraga is mica. How many people can prepare that, number one? Number two, even if they prepare, where is the evaluation or precision evaluation machinery to ascertain its genuinity, purity and efficacy? Number third, even if it is there, where is the sturdity level of a patient? Homeopathy, the medicines, it will work very nice if you are not taking tobacco, alcohol, coffee or tea. The rate of function will be more because of the body nature. Likewise, if a person is very much pure, ritualistic, then a lot of other qualities are there, spiritual qualities and intellectual qualities and mental sturdity is there. If the person is an empowerment or embodiment of all of these qualities, then certainly there are two possibilities. He won't get that risk at all, the type of disease at all. Number two, even if it is a karmic bondage to get the disease, he can have a good drug response. What is the benefit of spiritual life? Spiritual life gives you five benefits. It won't give you that type of cruel disease at all. Number two, even if it is given, it will be totally extirpated. It won't be sustainable. Number three, even if it is not sustainable, you are a good responsive person, spirit for a drug. Number four, even if it is there, you will be having the courage to face it. Number fifth, that is a greatness. even if you are having that disease, it won't affect your spiritual progress and your routinal work at all. These five things are the blessings of spirituality. This is very much interesting and very much awe-inspiring, which everybody must practice. Spiritual things, they don't demarcate or filter you from diseases. Apart from removal of diseases, response to drugs and mental sturdity and balance and the routinal way of continuing your prosperous and blissful life without minding the disease at all. If this is here, then what is the problem for me? I can just follow my pathway. Just as considering it as a different sheath, Annamaya Kosha, and our existence as a Vijnanamaya and Anandamaya, we don't mind that thing at all. It is just like a brick kept in a neighbor's house, or if a brick is kept inside this chair or inside your desk. So if something is kept at the top or inside or front and bottom of an insentient creature which is not connected with us, which we never mind, that don't affect, that does not having any proper way of creating an impact in our mental balance. Likewise, we consider this body as well as the malady and remedy to be unconcerned, totally far beyond our concern and necessity, so we won't get at all. These things are the pentafold blessings and benefits of spiritual courage, not spiritual belief. We are all believers. Believers won't get the benefits. Belief is a threshold for getting the courage. Belief is the threshold for getting power. Mere belief is not power. Most of the people are unorganized and spiritualism has not grown because most of the people, they must start with believers. Now they are carrying their own beliefs without progressing in the other successful pathways. They started with belief, running with belief, and they will end with just belief, not anything at all. That is the problem with the spiritual domain, where some renaissance, there's some lightning, there's some great person for the resurrection of the spiritual community must come as Ramanujacharya or somebody else is there, and they must reinstall the spiritual glory and sensibility and commitment of each and every person. That is entirely different. So this targeted therapy, all of these therapies are now in new innovation. Our own special therapies, like I have told in Ayurveda, then yoga consists of good therapies. Then Prakritika Chikitsa is naturopathy. It has lot of therapies. So a person, just by consuming, I may give some tips as we are planning to start one spa, Sanjeevani. Papaya, see, anything that is having a bitter taste is against cancer. You take juice of papaya, not papaya fruit. This is unripened papaya and nobody can drink, I think so. Just consuming it, spoon by spoon, at least 50 ml a day, it works very miraculously with these people. Then hydrotherapy. Then consuming just fruit, nothing else. That reduces 20% of advanced cancer and 65% of cancer in the beginning stage. Let us take a holistic way. And homeopathy, no doubt, it is having a good systemic study. It has not originated in our land. So we just leave it. This Prakriti Chikitsa is there. It is very efficacious. Yoga is also there. What is the capability of yoga, Prakriti Chikitsa and Ayurveda? What is the difference? Ayurveda as well as the naturopathy treatment, you have to advocate. But yoga is bivalent. You can do it for yourself as well as radiate others. Dhyana, asana you can do for yours. Yama and niyama you cannot do for others. Asana you cannot do for others. Pranayama and pratyahara you cannot do for others. But dhyana and dharana are the two experiences in the Eightfold Yogic Path meant for others. Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama, Pratyahara, Samadhi, all of these six steps are meant for self-experience and bliss. You cannot say that Samadhi is for him. That gives a different meaning. So this Dhyana and Dharana is communicable. The power of your contemplation, the power of your sincere, that is obeisance and obedience in spiritual practice and belief, that becomes a prowess which is transmitted, radiated even to non-believers. So by yoga, we can install such an institute where the practitioners can treat others. Where the treatment is for the patients, we can have naturopathy and Ayurveda. So yoga, Ayurveda, naturopathy, if somebody starts an institute with the guidance of an oncologist, a proper oncologist, because they must certify to the world that it works. There are a lot of people successfully having done in Kottakkal Ayurveda Pharmacy, in Kairali Ayurveda Pharmacy, even they have treated a lot of previous and present presidents of India. There are a lot of records with even Yogesh Bandale, and there are a lot of living legends of the records of success like Gadgilji. There are innumerable people like that. But still, for making it as a universal announcement and declaration with proof having eternal application and relevance with universal acceptability and authorization, it needs a different platform. So we must establish in our spa or any other area a holistic system of adoption. Then only we can get the utmost benefit. These are all the treatments. Then there is prognosis. What is prognosis in cancer? Prognosis is the art of predicting the lifestyle and lifespan of a patient after the treatment. How far he can run his life and how long he can carry it. How much he must be vigilant and meticulous. So all of these measures of life, all of his measurements of his life units, everything is studied in the science of prognosis. By seeing a patient, we must access and assess the person's durability, endurance and longevity as a post-treatment benefit by any of these methodologies. That is known as prognosis. Then six immediate connectivities for this cancer has been given by a lot of these people. One is the carcinogens, I have already told, like tobacco-like substances. Second is infection. Infection also creates problem. Third thing is radiation. Whenever the persons are working in radius, somebody told when we are giving lectures about meteorology, somebody asked, did our ancestors know that radioactive elements exist? That was the question. Then I told three reasons, some of which, one is, they knew about the radioactive elements as the radioactivity of those elements, the chemical elements, the geostatic or geodynamic radiological output that totally interferes and hinders with that of our biological radioactivity. So the bio, do you know that now cell phones, nobody is advocating to use cell phones in proximity. All of the electronic systems, we must be very careful. Nuclear reactors, we must be careful. Thermal power stations, we must be careful, because of not only their nature of giving fatal results or outputs, because of the incongruity between the bioelectronic as well as the geoelectronic or the phenomenal electronic fields, they don't accept at all. Our radiation is mild and effective. We have this much of systems inside our body, millions of nerves with millions of uncountable dimensions of functions they are advocating inside our body, and to create such a body with such type of functions and sustenance, the whole electrical production of the world and its voltage can sustain this body only for 3 seconds. According to the assessment, if we can create a body with all the responsive, reflexive, active, reactive, interactive principles of our body, if you are making it as an artificial thing, like what we call in science a cyborg, or a cyborobo, or an andro-robo, whatever it may be, if you create an organism with all of the functions and you want to supplement, instead of our consciousness, if you want to supplement it by electricity, the whole productivity of electricity in the world can make it run only for 3 seconds. So that much of the most mildest but very hyper-vigorous energy is within us, and it will contradict with these geospatial energy outputs, which are very much vigorous in nature but thus lesser functions and fatal functions. So we must be very careful with these things. The radiations that have been coming from, there is biological radiations, there is radioactive materials and radiations, there are radiations of various spheres through communication signals, they even affect the patients. There are radiations of various spheres through communication signals, they even affect the body. That is radiation. The third thing is infection, I have already told. Apart from these radiation things, I have already told about inheritance. By heredity, you can get a lot of such problems. So this type of various things that will result in the emergence of cancer. Now the World Cancer Society, they have given 8 major reasons for cancer. Number one is tobacco. Number one they have rated as tobacco. Second is alcoholism. That is very essential. Third thing is very beautiful. More vegetables and fruits you consume, lesser the risk of cancer is there. People, they have started taking lot of other things, cereals, pulses, and various other things. Even now they are not taking that, they are just drinking oil and spices in the pretext of a few morsels of rice inside it. So now they are consuming only spices and oils, and more than that, they are consuming only urea, potassium and other fertilizers which are just mixed with food. What we are taking is just the urea, potassium and other fertilizers decorated with grains, cereals and pulses. That's what we are taking. So this type of unhealthy food habits, in which foods, mainly it must possess fruits and vegetables, because fruits and vegetables are born out of the same earth in which we are dwelling. We are having institutional as well as configurative fraternity. That is, Sthavara and Jangama, they have constitutional fraternity. Even the so-called carnivorous animals, they don't consume carnivorous animals, only herbivorous. So there is a process of mutual understanding between these two kingdoms, plant and animal kingdom. So consuming these things, that will create more immunity, because they are exposed to two things. One is Dhyava and Prithivi. We are having floors and we are seated inside, we are having huts with roofs. So our exposure to the real Prithivi and Dhyava is being concealed. So reduced our immunity and response to the drugs and the other medical supports. So the only thing that is deeply fixed within the earth, as well as totally exposed to the sky, Dhyava, Prithivi, Shiva, Te, Ubhestham. This is absolutely followed only plants. So vegetables and fruits, they must be 2/3 of our meals. And 1/3 it must be anything. It is advocated by the World Cancer Research Council. Fruits and things. Fourth thing is physical exercise. Movement of your physical body that will prevent as unwanted material to be stagnated in some areas which may result in malignant tumor. The fourth thing. The fifth thing is unsafe sex. And the sixth thing is lot of other consumed things are connected with lot of pollutions. Full pollution in food, pollution in water and pollution in air. That's why we used to say the man has beautified earth but spoiled water, food and air. We told in one environmental congress. So he has made everything beautiful at the cost of making these three basic ingredients ugly. That is very worst. So this is very much essential to know that the pollution is also having the same effect. So all of these various factors have been given by the Cancer Research Council. Some other factors are so there. We cannot discuss all things today. Let me come to the conclusion. Number one, there are three things I have already told. One is inherited. Just putting everything in a precise package, there are reasons from the atmosphere, surroundings. There are reasons from your inner body, in your inner spirit. There are reasons which are out of inheritance. For removing these things only, our ancestors needed the support of three mega forces. For getting benefits which are their inner built and which are innate, they worshipped the Pitrus, the ancestors. For removing the maladies which have come out of the inheritance, they worship the rishis, the Gotra Mulapurushas. And for control over the surrounding forces and the domination and pollution, they worship the devatas. So whatever the inner reasons, contribution of the degradation, whatever the surroundings, whatever the inherited reasons, by sincere, loyal worship and divine approach towards the ancestors, the primogenitors, as well as the celestial authorities, Rishi, Pitru, Devata, they have been worshipped by our traditions for giving inner sources, inherited sources and circumstantial sources of favor. We have forgotten those things. We have forgotten not only to do those things, but also to patronize those people who are doing these things incessantly. Due to lack of patronage, you have left already due to insincerity and your misfortune. You also made these people to leave their practices. It is our duty to start it today and also to encourage and empower such embodiments of knowledge and practice to continue this three process of worship, which is going to contribute at least 65% or 70%. Let 30% your research, your scrutiny, lab experiments, let them come for rescue. More than what you do now. I don't want you to stop any of the experiment, medication or research. You do that thing, but do the thing with real spirit. Real value. Let it be vivified your spirit. Let it be vivified by your spiritual understanding and practice. Let us couple together the modern research, which is like an orphaned child in a festival. The science is like an orphaned child in a festival. It is just blinking here and there what to do and when to do and what will be the result. Let the orphaned child be embraced by the mother of our traditional knowledge. Let both of them dwell in mutual understanding, which will result in the prosperity, salubrity and spiritual tranquility. Overall happiness to all members of this global society. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan. Epigenetics, epigenetics, it deals with the response of your inner genes. Response of your inner genes inside a genome or inside a DNA. So these things cannot be activated in modern science except in genomics and pharmacogenomics. So to take a genomic exercise and to send a message to your inner cell, it will take at least $10 million for you to research and do the same thing. But with our sincerity, love and affection towards God, we can do it without even a penny price of expense. We can do that. That is there. So epigenetics is the study of inner response. So the response or the message apprehension of your own inbuilt genes inside your genome, as well as inside a DNA can be activated only by a spiritual process. So what we have to do is by proper medication and evaluation by a group of people in various communities. For example, there is also a process of screening and genetic testing. Genetic testing is there, screening is there. Now we are having chemo prevention. Each and everybody, before getting into cancer, there are some drugs which are infused inside, which will totally prevent the possibility of cancer. That is known as not chemotherapy, but chemo prevention. The modern science is there. You take some of these chemotherapies and preventive oncologies, put them in a lobby, whereby you just test a patient and produce his report, and also the report before the treatment and after the treatment, it can be very easily done. Epidemiology is very important. Epidemiology is a very important science. Certain people working in certain atmospheres, unavoidably they will get certain cancers. For example, persons who are with the chimney sweep, they are affected by the scrotum cancer. Recently they have discovered. So if you are having that much of mentality, for example, drug addiction is there. For example, alcoholism is more. For example, the working atmosphere is radioactive. It is very hyper-polluted. If persons working in an area are living even in an area where there is pollution rate more, they will get some diseases, epidemiology. So epigenetics, that is known as inner response of your body, and epidemiology is the outer response to your body. This must be, that is what I call holistic. You are having yoga, and yoga is a mind sense. You are transmitting your higher level of mind and consciousness with utmost divinity, purity, serenity towards some other person. If you are not a good producer, if he is not a good receptacle, if the medium is not good, even though we are deserving and desiring, then we may not get the result. So for any support as supplementary issues, we must take some portions of sciences like basic pathology, pathobiology, pathophysiology, this epidemiology and epigenetics. We can keep, no doubt we must keep some areas for detection, for proper diagnosis, assurance and evaluation of our body growth and progress. Certainly we must have a holistic system. Whenever we join together with the modern technology as well as our traditional technology, that area will going to be a successful area where everybody is going to accept the greatness of our art.
We always discuss this Ayurveda in Charaka Samhita, the first chapter, the 17th shloka. It is clearly stated that when Bharadwaja went to Brahmadeva to get the knowledge of Ayurveda, he was in Dhyanavastha. Now that is a crucial thing. If you are going to do any research, according to me, on Ayurveda, you mentioned that Dhyana and Dharana, that has got some different objective, but Samadhi is one way of getting into that, Bharadwaja did to get this knowledge of Ayurveda. Patanjali has clearly stated, Nabhi Chakra Sharira Yojnana. Now, today I find that this aspect of Ayurvedic knowledge, which is really obtained by Bharadwaja, is totally ignored. I asked one of the students of Ayurveda, he knew this verse, he knew. He said, yes, chapter 1, verse 17 contains all these particular things. I said, what do you do with that? He said, we ignore it totally and completely.
Yes.
Sir, is there a way to get into this mode of obtaining medicines for cancer as well?
Number one, lot of the shastras, even the normal shastras, were revealed by the seers, their preceptors, only by penance and austerity. Even meteorology, even the Rasarnava, the alchemy, the Vaimanika Shastra, Bharadwaja in aeronautics, even the mundane sciences, they have been revealed by our ancestors through penance austerity. And this Samadhi is ecstatic trance. And the ecstatic trance is divine bliss, and that is divine experience, and that does not come for the rescue of the society and Shastras. Tapa Alochane, that is the Dhatu. If somebody is interested in the revelation of a knowledge for relief of a society, rescue of a society, they go in penance for thousands of years and get those things. How Sayanacharya, Bhaskaracharya and Aryabhatta, they could exactly derive at the speed of light, the diameter of the earth, distance between earth and moon, earth and sun, how they can derive these things without the support of any scientific meteorological experiments or the instruments which are available now. Exactly they could do that because of their penance and austerity. That type of contemplative lineage, that is Upasana Parampara, has been totally discarded. Now the Ayurveda, present Ayurveda, that is just with materia medica, pathology, physiology and anatomy. Now the Ayurveda is very much limited. It is a very wonderful question. It is an eye-opener, at least for the believers, the Astikas of the Ayurvedas, who are not treating it as just a material or a medical treatise. They must consider it. It is a very important subject. Number one, all the Vedic scriptures are on basis of 9 qualities. Yesterday, day before yesterday, while defining a Brahmana or Rishi, I gave this explanation. It is very much essential to represent this here also. One thing, each and everybody is processed by samskaras. So the first blessing or benefit for a person is samskara. After the samskara is over, the person gets into swadhyaya, resumption of Vedas. So first the person is purified by refinement, the process of refinement. Then he enters into swadhyaya, recitation of Vedas. Then after the swadhyaya is over, or in the process of swadhyaya, he develops certain qualities. They are known as shamadamadi guna. If you enter into swadhyaya, what is the benefit? Shama and dama, external and internal restraint. In the process of shama and dama, you will get lot of hindrance. To balance that, you have to develop tapas and brahmacharya. Tapas and brahmacharya will be disturbed by lot of factors. To remove those obstacles, you must get into achara and anushtana. So a person with samskara must rest in swadhyaya. Samskara and swadhyaya must take resort into shamadhamadi guna. Samskara, swadhyaya and shamadhamadi guna must get into tapas and brahmacharya. Samskara, swadhyaya, shamadhamadi guna, tapa and brahmacharya must follow achara and anushtana for protection. It is like the sealed cup or a well-packed, air-tagged packed cup which preserves it from vaporization or any other external disturbance. So a person with this samskara, swadhyaya, shamadhamadi guna, tapa brahmacharya and achara anushtana will get only real bhakti. Whatever we have bhakti is just a solace or inner comfort or artificial comfort or unknown fear. It is not bhakti at all. The real bhakti comes from this product. If a person has bhakti with the above requisites, then only he will indulge into real havana, pujana, yajana, bhojana, bhajana. He will get into this process. That person only will produce kripa, audarya and other good gunas. That person will get only tejas and shakti. And he is only a rishi and brahmana. He can only help the world. So, samskara, swadhyaya, shamadamadi guna, tapa, brahmacharya, achara nishtana, bhakti, havana pujana, then audari kripadi guna, which evinces in the form of tejashan shakti, radiation, permeation and vibration, vitalization, resurrection of the universal forces. Actually, you must understand that helmet is for those people who are having these two-wheelers. If you are not having this thing at all, what is the use of mere helmet? Why you are wearing like an astronaut? So likewise, Ayurveda is a Upaveda. So a person who has mastered Ayurveda must have mastered Veda. After Veda Sikshana only it has been advised. Swadhyayo Adhyetavyaha. First you must go into Swadhyaya. As soon as your Vedic erudition education is over in these three processes, one is the process of recitation, second is the process of ritualization, third is the process of realization. If these things are over, then only you must come to the sublimes. There are three major sublimes. One is yoga, second is Ayurveda, third is Jyotisha. Jyotisha includes Vastu. Now we are seeing lot of people dissociated with the Vedic wisdom. They don't know anything about the Vedas, having come for the rescue of the society through astrological predictions, through Ayurvedic medications and through mystic prescriptions. How it is possible? They can get only the peripheral benefits. They can get only the peripheral benefits. See, we are taking all good things. And we are throwing this, just as you are going to peel off the oranges or other fruits, you are going to consume the fleshy portions and throwing the skins outside. That will be consumed by animals and some other unwanted people in these fields. Likewise, whatever that is thrown unwanted, that is a peripheral portion which is just like a corpse portion without the spirit inside is consumed by the modern people and now they are serving the society. Whenever the Vedic society creates, according to the norms and requirements of the society, after Vedic knowledge is acquired, if they practice yoga, they will be 200% successful. Not only yoga, Ayurveda and also Jyotisha. Now it is a pitiable situation of the society that person just knowing 27 nakshatras and their names, just immediately they start with a board that they are doing astrological research. 60% and 40% of the people even don't know their names. So let us create an integrated system of Vedic knowledge with yoga, Ayurveda and Jyotisha, which is going to really serve the society. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.